have been known from time to time to complain about elected officials. Are there great elected officials in the state of Connecticut? Yes, there are. For example, there is Senator Rob Sampson from Wolcott. How are you, sir?
I am well, Todd. Thanks for letting me join you today.
Well, thank you for being great. How's that for making you uncomfortable with compliments?
Yes, I'm just doing my job, that's all. I took an oath to uphold the Constitution and defend the liberties of my constituents, and I take that very seriously.
I thought that whole liberty thing was over.
It certainly seems like that when you're at the state capitol, I will tell you that.
So guns, you're a gun guy. Tell us about this ammo tax.
Yeah, so the ammo tax is a bill that was proposed by Representative Jillian Gilchrist of West Hartford. She actually proposed it last year, too, except she wanted to make the tax 50% last time around. And clearly, when you propose a tax on bullets for 50%, you're not being serious. You're trying to make a political statement. And that's what it was seen as last time around. And I think the bill was summarily rejected on that basis.
For being too brazenly political?
Yeah, brazenly, overtly political, and obnoxious besides.
And 35% is enough of a back-off to have more credibility? What's your feeling?
No, I don't think it's credible at all. I think it's still brazenly obnoxious, and it is overtly political. The difference is that this time she did it right. You know, she held a formal press conference. She got allies out in the anti-gun community to join her on stage. And she got the House Majority Leader, Representative Matt Ritter of Hartford, to stand there with her. And to me, that was a real eye-opener. Because when an individual legislator goes out and puts out some wacky bill, I mean, who cares? But when the majority leader's standing there, it's like, wait, this bill's not so wacky anymore, because it means they really want it. And I don't really know the truth to that statement. I just find it amazing that the majority leader will put his name on it. Although, you know, being a representative from Hartford, he does not have a lot to worry about. So yesterday with the public hearing, I actually tried to stop the public hearing because we have a vote. The very first action on a bill is a decision whether or not to have a hearing or not.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very rare to actually even have a roll call vote or any objection. Normally, everyone just agrees that, well, it's only to agree to have a conversation, so we'll all support it on a voice vote, and that's the end of it. But because I find this proposal to be overtly political and obnoxious, I certainly wasn't going to say, oh, yeah, I'm down for a hearing. So I objected and asked for a roll call vote along with my Republican colleagues. And, you know, we failed, but at least we made a statement there.
Do you think that affected some of the votes of the Democrats that they had to go on the record?
Not really, although one Democrat did vote no. Every Republican voted no, and every Democrat voted yes, except for one. I think what it did do is that I think it gave some strength to the Republicans. I think they were kind of on the spot to make sure that they were going to defend the Second Amendment in that case. And I think that that's good, because there have been Republicans in recent years that have voted in favor of modest gun control measures, some of them not so modest.
Yep.
And I really want to at least get the Republicans to stand fast for the Constitution.
Oh, so that's interesting. So it had the effect of holding Republicans in place who might have been tempted to do a little pandering.
Right. And to have the result of the vote come out as a party line vote, I think, is a good thing. I think that at least
protects everybody and makes a strong statement.
Right. As you know, Todd, listening every day, the people of Connecticut, what they want more than anything out of Republicans is a true opposition party, one that will stand up and fight against the constant onslaught of big government and our liberties being taken away. And anything I can do to get my colleagues on the Republican side to stand tall with me and be that opposition party, I'm going to make every effort to make
well,
happen.
Well, as you know, Rob Sampson, that's my mission. I want Republicans to be the opposition party. I want them to stand tall. And I'm wondering if the Democrats, going wild with so much overtly bad legislation and ideas like tolls, I wonder if it's starting to have some effect where Republicans can feel more confident standing up for what's right.
I think that they are using their same old playbook, but it's not working anymore. Their playbook has always been to, in an election year, get their base riled up. A lot of times they don't act on this kind of, you know, really extreme leftist legislation, but they put it out there because they want to get their people energized. They want to get their people enthusiastic about the campaign and fired up. The thing is, this time they have less and less people fired up because their ideas are that much more crazy than they were the last time.
But there's also a timing issue.
Time before.
There's a timing issue, too, Rob, where they just finished the tolls thing and they pushed the toll thing into the session. So they went from horrible idea on tolls to horrible idea on denying religious liberties on horrible idea with ammo tax. Do you think they just failed to anticipate what they were doing to themselves?
The whole toll thing is inexplicable to me. I can't even remember, Todd, I'm the guy who's been saying since a year ago that we're never going to vote on tolls.
You did say that, yes.
And, you know, and every time it was imminent, oh, we're going to vote on Tuesday. Oh, it's going to be Thursday. Oh, watch out.
I would call you and I would say, Rob, what's going to happen? And you'd say, well, you know what I think. I don't think there's ever going to be a vote on tolls.
And I still think there's going to be no vote on tolls. At least
hold on one sec, Rob. We've got to get a traffic and weather update. Traffic and weather together on the 8th, as a matter of fact. Yes, they are a strange brew, those Democrats. We're talking to State Senator Rob Sampson from Wolcott. He is a stalwart in the fight for liberty, and we appreciate you doing that, Rob. Thank you for reporting back on all your efforts.
It's my pleasure. I appreciate the opportunity.
So before you go, I just want to give you some time to give us a little presentation of where you think this session is at. What is going to happen in your mind? What have you seen that looks like dangerous legislation that people should be aware of that hasn't gotten much publicity, anything like that?
Well, there's a laundry list of bad things happening. But let me say a quick thing or two about the ammo tax and the vaccine issue, since that's first and foremost in a lot of people's minds.
Sure.
The one thing that I thought was really interesting is that unlike your typical gun control legislation that the left puts out, this time they actually supplied reasons along with their crazy and wacky ideas. Instead of just saying we want to tax bullets 35%, which is obnoxious enough, Representative Gilchrist actually sat across from me in the public hearing yesterday and told me that the reason why she wants this tax is because every person who lawfully owns a firearm is responsible for gun violence by virtue of the fact that every gun that is out there that is being used in crime, no matter how rare they are all the result of lawfully purchased firearms at some point in the past. I'm like, this
that's
is
some beautiful
madness.
Logic.
Yeah, it's inexplicable to me. I don't understand how you can be so bold. And I said, do you understand that there's a whole bunch of people in this room who are, you know, hardworking, decent people that are buying firearms for sport and for personal protection? And these are the kind of people that would rush into a tragedy to prevent it from happening. And you're blaming them for the terrible acts of criminals. But there's no remorse. The left just sees people that want to express their own freedom as evil. And I don't know how to overcome that. But the good news is we don't have to, because I don't need to convince Representative Gilchrist of anything. I just got to make sure that the average man on the street understands why freedom and opportunity are important. And that's why your show is so important, and I appreciate you.
Well, I was just going to say the same thing about what you're doing in terms of highlighting this sort of irrational leftism that is taking hold amongst a certain group of legislators, where as long as it doesn't have anything to do with this being a free society, or believing in people's rights to live their own lives, or believing in the beautiful effect that markets have on mankind. You know, none of the things that America is based on match up with their agenda. And the more you can shine a spotlight on it, down at this nitty-gritty level of legislation, I think you do us all a great service.
Well, I appreciate that. And I use every opportunity. I testified in front of the Housing Committee yesterday about protecting private contracts between tenants and landlords. And, of course, you know, anything that you do is conceived as somehow benefiting rich landlords. But this is an example of every aspect of policy. They want to interfere and have the government take the role of one side or the other to give them a benefit. And that's the exact opposite of what this country was founded on.
Especially with this aspect of demonizing somebody, too. So they want to create an enemy of some class of people who are our fellow Americans.
Yes, employers, landlords, anyone they perceive that they can get a benefit by appearing to help the other side of the transaction. And usually they do it by who's on the majority side of the transaction, because that's the original math of socialism, isn't it, Todd?
Yes.
There's always going to be more poor people than rich people. So let's screw over the rich people, and we'll use the money to buy the support of the poor people. That's the invention of socialism. That's how the Democrats operate. And almost every policy that they create now is for that purpose. It's written with the intent of gaining favor with various constituency groups at the expense of others.
But it's very dangerous to go around demonizing our fellow citizens, and particularly people who are out there actively taking risk and making efforts to grow our economy and grow our state.
Right. Well, it's the narrative of Atlas Shrugged is playing out. What's shocking to me is just how much they get away with, because it's so unbelievably transparent. But they get caught once in a while. And the vaccine issue is one of those issues where they're getting caught, because people that have been going about their lives, many of them millennial moms, been voting Democrat because they believe that the Democrats are the great protectors of the working class and mothers and women and everything else. And they're suddenly realizing, hey, these people don't care about you and your choices in life. And it's not your body, your choice. It's the government wants to tell you how to raise your own child and make decisions.
Yes.
And boy, did that wake up a great many people.
Well, that's...
And amazingly, Todd, at the ammo tax hearing yesterday, there were people there that have nothing to do with guns, but they are recognizing the value of freedom because of that vaccine issue, and they came to testify against that bill.
Well, thank you. This is exactly what I'm hoping is happening, that people are starting to see the thread that connects all of these issues.
We need phase two, though. Phase two is that these folks got to be engaged in this upcoming election and help us remove those terrible people that are taking our freedoms away from office.
Oh, we are mobilizing. Have no fear. Senator Rob Sampson, thank you, sir.
My pleasure. Thanks for the opportunity.
We'll talk to you soon. Have a great weekend. To you soon. Have a great weekend.